वगैरह हमने लास्ट क्लास में एस्टैब्लिश किया था, वी एस्टैब्लिश दैट ऑल वोल्टेज वाज इक्वल टू बी आई, बी बीइंग मैग्नेटिक फील्ड स्ट्रेंथ, आई बीइंग द करंट अपॉन एनईटी, एन बीइंग द नंबर ऑफ चार्ज कैरियर्स मल्टीप्लाइड बाय चार्ज ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन मल्टीप्लाइड बाय थिकनेस. फ्रॉम ए टू बी इफ इट इज मूविंग राइट, देयर इज नो मैग्नेटिक फील्ड हियर, बट एज सून एज इट रीचेस पॉइंट आई इट कम्स अंडर द इन्फ्लुएंस ऑफ अ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड and therefore there is a Hall voltage because of the magnetic field. As soon as it leaves off point E, the magnetic field is there no more, and that is why there is no voltage, there is no Hall voltage observed. If you were to draw a graph of Hall voltage against thickness or distance, that would have been an inverse proportion. For inverse proportion, we have a graph of this. Right. Moving forward, expression for calculating magnetic force on a current carrying conductor. Please understand that a current carrying conductor, when moves perpendicular to the field, there will be a force observed, which is maximum. If it is moving parallel to the field, similar to the charges, there is no force observed. Right? You need to understand one thing, that at an angle, the force is BIL sine theta. If you were to draw a graph of F against sine theta, please understand that it is a direct relationship, and that is why a straight line. However, if you were to draw a graph of F against theta, the theta values vary from 0 to 90. And the sine graph, which looks like this, at 90 degree, this is 180 degree, this is 360 degree. So at 90 degree, it stops till here. So my graph similarly would also stop off till here. Somewhat like this. Forward, whenever a current carrying wire is placed in a uniform magnetic flux density, uniform magnetic field of flux density B, Tesla, it experiences a magnetic force. You need to understand, just a reminder, that the force and the magnetic field lines and the movement of the wire should be perpendicular to one another, somewhat like this. Right? Moving forward, there is no force experienced. There is no force experienced when the conductor is positioned parallel to the field. For maximum force, the direction of the current must be perpendicular to the field lines. Now, based on the above equation, the magnetic flux density is said to be equal to 1 Tesla. They ask you for this definition. They ask you for this definition that it would be 1 Tesla if the conductor of unit length carrying unit current in the direction perpendicular to the field experiences a force of 1 Newton. Basically, you have simply defined of this formula. Expressions for calculating the magnetic field associated with a current carrying wire. Please understand that for a current carrying wire, the magnetic field is produced in its neighborhood. If a wire moves around paper, let's say. Right, it is coming out. The wire, according to the right hand grip rule, will have its own magnetic field. My thumb, according to right hand grip rule from O levels, you know that. My thumb points in the direction upward. My fingers will curl off in this direction, thereby telling me that each wire will have its own magnetic field and its direction can be worked off using the right hand grip rule. For a current carrying out of the page, direction of this magnetic field is anti-clockwise in this direction. Whereas for current going into the page, the magnetic field is in the clockwise direction. At any point, the direction of the field can be worked out by making a tangent at that point. The strength of this magnetic field is given by the formula B is equals to mu naught I upon 2 pi t. I is the current in the wire, d is the distance. Let's say I have a wire out of the page. According to the right hand grip rule, there is a magnetic field for out of the page, which is in the anti-clockwise direction. If you were asked to calculate the direction of the magnetic field at this point, you just simply draw a tangent. For into the page, it is in the clockwise direction. Expressions for calculating magnetic force experienced by two current carrying conductors. Please understand that whenever there are two like currents, they will always attract. For unlike currents, they will repel off. These field lines actually interact with each other, thereby exerting a force on the wire. In this case, like currents experience an attractive force. The unlike ones will experience a repulsion or a repulsive force. The formula for the force is given. F is equals to mu naught I1 I2 upon 2 pi d. Right, mu naught has this value specifically. You will be provided with the mu naught value. For example, I have a 5 ampere current and a 3 ampere current. You need to understand that there is same force even when the two currents are different, because according to Newton's third law, the force which one body applies onto the other is equal and opposite to what the other body applies on it. Right? DC implies that magnitude of the force remains constant. DC is direct current, AC is alternating current. Because AC will have its graph somewhat like this in the above direction. So for example, if I1 was AC, I1 had this graph. I2 was AC, it had this graph. You need to understand that F is equals to I1, I2. Let's say both of these values were termed as I1, you could say. Or even if they multiply off, they both will have a square. And the sine wave in its square form looks like this. For one complete cycle of an alternating current, the force varies between 0 and its magnitude. Like, let's just say this was one current. This was the other current. You need to understand that both of these are out of phase simply because they're unlike currents. And when they're out of phase, you simply square. Let's say this value was 4 ampere. This one was minus 4 ampere. If you were to multiply them, they would be 16. However, there's a negative sign that reflects this entire graph throughout, right? So with alternating currents, the current carrying wire appears to vibrate. Practical example, usually there are overhead cables, but this vibration is not really seen because they are placed horizontally and the force should be enough to overcome the weight of the wire. For example, I have one wire having a current of 200 ampere. Right, its length is from 10 meter to 30 meter, diameter is 30 centimeter to 50 centimeter. You have the formula F is equals to mu naught I1 I2 times L divided by 2 pi d. I'm simply substituting the values and I will get a magnetic force value of 0.16 newton. Please understand that this value is extremely small when compared with the weight of the wire. Therefore, it is not possible for you to see of the vibration. However, the wires placed vertically will actually be seen to vibrate because the component of weight will not have to be worked upon or had to be overcome. For a solenoid of negligible weight, suggest why length of the solenoid must contract when the current flows through. Let's say I have current flowing through the circuit. It goes around somewhat like this, right? Please understand that both of these flow in the same direction. And when they flow in the same direction, they resemble like currents will attract, and therefore the wires will come close to one another. Each circular turn of a solenoid can be assumed to be behaving as a current carrying wire producing its own magnetic field. If the turns are closely spaced out, then the individual magnetic field interacts with each other. This results in a force being produced, which, according to Newton's third law, is equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. Hence, it makes the turns move towards each other. They specifically ask you this sort of a question in the exam. Generated when a current carrying wire is placed in a magnetic field. Please understand that if a current carrying wire is placed in a magnetic field, according to Fleming's left hand rule, my first finger My first finger points in the direction of the field, that is from north to south. My second finger is the direction of the current. The third finger, the thumb, points in the direction of the force. So if you were to apply Fleming's left hand rule, your first finger should be from north to south. Your second finger should be from A to B. And you will realize that your thumb points in the upward direction, thereby exerting a force, causing the coil to move upward from here and downward from this end. Right? You need to understand that torque is equal to force into perpendicular distance. Right? Your force in a magnetic field is BIL, because there's a current carrying wire. Perpendicular distance is BC. Perpendicular distance from this area is BC, right? I am terming BC as W, which is the width of this coil. Please understand that the length multiplied by the width would simply mean the area. So assuming that if there are n number of turns of this coil, this entire torque formula can be worked off as BIAM. So the diagram below represents a rectangular coil positioned between two permanent magnets. The coil is connected to a DC power supply, which is not shown in the diagram. By DC, we mean there are simply a positive pole and a negative pole, and the direction of the current is marked on the coil. Based on Fleming's left hand rule, the coil experiences a force which makes the side AB move upwards and the side CD move downwards. No force is experienced on the other two sides because the current and the field lines are both parallel. The torque of the couple produced can be worked out using the equation. इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक इंडक्शन, मैग्नेटिक फ्लक्स इज बेसिकली द कटिंग इफेक्ट. लेट्स से आई हैव मैग्नेट्स, मैग्नेट्स विल हैव अ फील्ड लाइन. आई विल टेक अ वायर, दिस इज बाय द वे इन थ्री डायमेंशन. आई विल टेक अ वायर, I will first move it from down to up and then up to down, which means I'm constantly cutting the magnetic field lines. And when I cut the magnetic field lines, there is a magnetic flux generated. Had the wire been filled with some turns, this magnetic flux would be termed as magnetic flux linkage. So magnetic flux is defined as the product of magnetic flux density and the area of the coil. Given that the area is perpendicular to the field lines, magnetic flux is also called the cutting effect. Let's say if I have a circular coil and I am moving it up and down, meaning to say perpendicular to the field lines, there is a flux generated. However, if I am moving it parallel, there is no flux generated. If it is at an angle, we need to understand that we take the sine component, and therefore this becomes dA sine theta. The unit of flux is Weber or Tesla meter squared. This is Tesla, this is meter square. If there are certain turns on the coil, there is the number of turns will be multiplied and are given the symbol N, and this then becomes the magnetic flux linkage. So if the area consists of a large number of turns, then the total magnetic flux or the cutting effect is now termed as magnetic flux linkage and given by the formula NBA. Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, they will definitely ask you either directly or indirectly. This is a very important concept. Faraday's law states that the induced EMF is equal to the rate of change of magnetic flux or magnetic flux linkage. Meaning to say, if I keep on cutting the field lines, if I keep on constantly cutting the field line, as soon as I cut a field line, there is a voltage induced. If I constantly keep on cutting them, the voltage is constantly induced. Okay. Let's say I have a coil, right? I have a coil of wire connected to a voltmeter. Right? Initially, there's a magnetic field going in this direction as shown. As soon as I push it forward, the magnetic field strength in this, this is a non-uniform magnetic field, right? Since the field lines are closed, there's a greater magnetic field in this area and there's a less magnetic field in this area. So I keep pushing the coil inward. And then I push it backward. I am constantly cutting the magnetic field lines. And when I cut the magnetic field lines, according to Faraday's law, I am inducing an EMF. Right? According to Faraday's law, EMF is equals to rate of change of magnetic flux, d phi upon dt. Right? So you simply plug in the values provided to you and you can work off that the EMF value is 12 millivolt. Please understand that the actual reading, this is an average value or a mean value. The actual reading will differ, right? Because it is instantaneously changing at every single instant. It is changing. So this value is simply from the formula an average value. Right? The voltmeter will give you the instantaneous values. Let's say if you're pushing it in, you would definitely get greater values than 12 millivolt. And when you pull it back, you would get very low values when compared with 12 millivolts. So from the formula, this answer is an average value. Right? Let's say I have a uniform magnetic field. Since a uniform magnetic field, therefore, this will not give any change in magnetic flux. However, moving it in up and down direction or rotating it about its axis will give you a change because it will now constantly keep on cutting the magnetic field lines. So let's say if I'm rotating it from this position to this position, I've actually cut the field lines. Initially, the direction of the wire was parallel, right? Please understand that when you rotate the coil, initially it was perpendicular. The wire direction is perpendicular. The direction of the wire is perpendicular because current in the wire flows in this direction. As soon as I rotate it, it becomes parallel to the field. You are asked to calculate the EMF value. So according to Fleming's left-hand rule, EMF final, the final phi value minus the initial value. The initial value is NVA. Had you been provided with the values, you could actually work off the answer. Somewhat, this would be the expression. Let's say they had asked you to derive it, and this is how you would have done it. The negative sign indicates that the needle is deflected in the other way, which does not matter because what matters is the voltage being produced. Let's say I'm placing a wire. I am moving the wire up and down. For the first part, it is giving you a value, and for the second part, it's again giving you a value in the opposite direction. So this keeps on going as it keeps cutting the magnetic field lines. Right? Please understand that when rotating 180 degree, your NVA shifts to negative NVA. And had you been asked to calculate the change, final minus initial, because it's the direction matters, right? Let's say you had a search coil, the magnetic field is into the paper, right? The search coil has current in this direction. As soon as it enters the magnetic field line, the force is generated in the upward direction. And therefore, a positive induced EMF. Right, now you're entering it from here. Right, if you use Fleming's left hand rule here, you'd get a negative force value and hence a negative EMF value. Right, you need to understand one thing. That from O levels, you know that there is V is equals to IR. If there is an induced voltage, it would give rise to an induced current as well. Lenz's law simply states that because of the induced EMF, there is an induced current, and the current will flow in a direction so as to oppose the change that causes it. induced EMF gives rise to the flow of induced current. The direction of this induced current can be worked out using Lenz's law. According to this law, induced current flows in a manner so as to oppose the change causing it. This law can be demonstrated using the arrangement in figure 1 and figure 2. Let's say I had a magnet, right? The magnet is placed close to a solenoid. Now you need to understand that as the magnet approaches the solenoid will induce a north pole so as to repel this. As soon as a north pole is induced here, you need to understand that the flow of current is in this direction, right? Right hand grip rule. I worked this off from the right hand grip rule, right? Now, as soon as the magnet enters the solenoid, it will cut its magnetic field lines. And when it cuts the magnetic field lines, it will induce an EMF, because cutting effect leads to an EMF value. Now that when I'm pulling the magnet outside, this solenoid will induce a south pole here so as to attract the magnet, because it does not want the change happening. And when a south is induced here, according to Fleming's right hand grip rule, your thumb points in the north direction, your fingers will curl in the direction of the field, and you will realize your current flowing somewhat in this direction. Right? Please understand one thing, that when the magnet was moving downwards, the induced current flowed in the opposite direction, meaning to say it was opposing the change that causes it, thereby confirming Lenz's law. When the wire was being moved upwards, the current flowed in the opposite direction, that is downwards. Had you left this arrangement, the magnet would keep on moving down, but you would realize that the induced current, since is opposing it, it would cause some sort of a resistance, or you could say damping, thereby leading on to a loss in energy. This damping is the light damping. So based on the right hand grip rule, the direction of induced current flows from A to B, confirming Lenz's law. In figure 2, when the north pole is pulled out, the induced current now flows from direction B to A. Once again, confirming Lenz's law, since the motion of the magnet is continuously opposed, therefore its oscillations can be classified as damped oscillations. Mechanical energy of the magnet will be used up in overcoming the opposing force. Therefore, the amplitude of oscillation will continue to decrease. The magnitude of this damping can be reduced by introducing a resistor. Basically, you need to oppose the induced current, right? A resistor serves this purpose. A resistor will reduce the value of the induced current. This causes the size of the induced current to reduce. Hence, weaker poles are induced across the solenoid. Therefore, less degree of damping. Hence, the oscillations would continue for a longer duration. If, however, the resistance is made infinite by leaving the switch open, then the black dotted graph, this one, starts approaching the blue solenoid graph. One thing you need to understand is that this induced current is also called eddy current. expression for calculating induced EMF when a wire conductor is placed in a magnetic field. You have the diagram somewhat like this, right? If you use Fleming's left-hand rule, right? You will realize let's say this coil is moving in this direction. The motion is in this direction. Let's say the motion is in this direction. Your first finger, north to south, your motion in this direction. Right? You will realize that a force is exerted downwards. Now you need to realize from here that in the given diagram, when the wire labeled as AB is connected to a voltmeter and its position in a magnetic field induced EMF is zero. When the wire is either stationary or it is moving parallel to the magnetic field, in both the cases, the induced EMF is zero. However, if the wire is moved either upwards or downwards or both ways, then it will cut the magnetic field lines, thereby inducing the EMF. This induced EMF is given by the equation E is equals to BLV, where B is the magnetic flux, L is the length of the wire, V is the speed of the wire. This induced EMF will give rise to an induced current. Please note that Fleming's left-hand rule is used to figure out the force on a moving charged particle or a moving wire, you could say, or a wire carrying current. However, Fleming's right-hand rule is used to work out the direction of the induced current, which comes as a result of an induced EMF. Everything is the same, just the opposite direction. The first finger represents the magnetic field, the thumb represents the direction of motion, and the second finger represents the direction of the induced current. If you have the diagram, you put your first finger from Fleming's left hand rule, north to south, right? You take the movement in this direction. Right? Or you could say, yeah. So you'd realize that the magnetic force is working downwards. However, let's say I am pulling the wire upward. The point being, if I'm pulling the wire downwards, the induced current will cause the wire to move upwards. Both of these can be worked out using Fleming's rule. For the induced current, you can work it off through the right-hand rule from